Well, she was this wonderful Italian import. She was a big sex goddess. God, I mean, Bella Sofia.
I think she had the same thing that Cleopatra must have had. She had a commanding presence.
Sophia Loren, aside from being extremely beautiful physically, is one of the most exciting, witty women on this planet.
What she became, of course, is unique. Sophia is the only honest-to-God international movie star.
Sophia Loren has long been regarded one of the most acclaimed Italian stars in the history of film. While Italy has no traditionally structured star system, like Hollywood or other Western film industries, what they have are household names. Performers that manage to make a name for themselves through their prowess and, more often than not, their associations. Hello. Sophia Loren was brought up in a small town near Naples, which had been crippled by financially following the Second World War. She got her start in beauty pageants and working as an extra on Hollywood film productions. And many cite it was her natural southern beauty that got her recognised by filmmakers like Dino Risi, Vittoria De Sica, and Carlo Ponti. However, I feel it would be a disservice to reduce her significance down to her looks and her connections, and to overlook her talent and her performances in comedic roles, which resonated with audience at the time of her rise to stardom. Comedy seems to be the key to success in Italian cinema, as it is often the most popular genre and the only one currently that can compete with Hollywood's blockbuster output. At the time of recording this essay, the number one film at the box office is Ma cosa ti dice il cervello, a spy comedy led by Paolo Cortellesi, the second subject I will be analysing. Cortellesi became wildly known as a child singer and by doing musical skits on television variety shows.
Un dì mi ritrovai sul limitar di un bosco di genziani, sì, però m'ade data mo.
Parodying famous musicians and films before branching out into film herself to become Italy's current most popular female star. In this video essay, I will be comparing the careers of Sophia Loren and Paolo Cortellesi, and analysing the ways in which they can refract the historical periods in which they became popular. Through this, I will explore the evolution of gender representation in Italian cinema, contrasting specifically the portrayals of working-class women, and approaching the question of why Loren's star persona became a global commodity, while Cortellesi's has remained culturally specific.
Was it the hard struggle you had in your childhood, do you think, that gave you the ambition and the drive to become the success you are?
Can be part of it, yes.
I mean, it's true that you were hungry.
But you can be ambitious, you can dream about success, you can have it. But I don't think that if you don't have a talent, you can't last very long. Impossible.
Are you sure that you had a talent that you were born with, or did you learn?
Well, then I was not sure, but I think now for the things that I have done, maybe a little talent I have.
At this point, it might be helpful to define and differentiate Loren's and Cortellesi's individual star statuses. Garrity's essay on stardom is useful in analysing this through the cinematic presence of our two actresses. In her words, the concept of stardom has been important from studies because it related to the dominant ways of theorising film which developed in the 1970s and 1980s. Like genre, work on stars offered the possibility of looking at the whole cinematic process through work on production, text and audiences. More specifically, the significance of stars could be explained through theories which are developed to consider how meaning was generated in the film text more generally. Garrity outlines three different classifications of stars: the celebrity, the professional, and the performer. In my opinion, Cortellesi clearly falls into the professional category, which involves a star image becoming strongly defined through the context of a particular genre. This in Cortellesi's case being comedy. The slow building of her career and recognition through television allows for the building up of a loyal fan base and for fluidity across television and film, which only aids in the growth of said fan base and notoriety within the industries. Her aptitude for impressions lends to Cortellesi's abilities to transform completely into the characters she plays, down to the enunciation of different Italian dialects.
Per favore, non toccate la macchina grigia!
Which is no small feat, and certainly sets her apart. Lastly, her identification with the comedy genre, though not wholly ascribed to, but is nonetheless facilitated by her working relationship with her husband, Riccardo Milani, a comedic director who is responsible for several modern successes in which Cortellesi has starred.
Piombo, il piombo si adatta perfettamente, soprattutto a te. Sì.
Il successo è talento, bellezza, fortuna. In quale percentuale?
Talento.
Prima di tutto.
Eh beh, certo. Fortuna.
E poi
bellezza.
Sophia Loren, on the other hand, I feel fits the star as performer paradigm. As Geraghty explains it, stars as performers are marked by an emphasis on impersonation, on a distinction between star and role which is effaced in the star as professional. In this situation, acting has become a way of claiming back the cinema for human stars. The emphasis on emotion expressed through gesture and sound, rather than words, fitted the dethroning of the script and the word by cinema's visual possibilities. The emphasis on the expressiveness of the body could be accommodated in cinema's use of the spectacle. The emphasis on inner character was consonant with cinema's promotion of stars as unique and authentic individuals. Sophia Loren's dramatic talents stem from her ability to emote through facial expression and gesture, and the allure of her sex appeal allowed her to transcend the language barrier in a way that Paolo Cortellesi would struggle to. In spite of her own attractiveness and undeniable range of talent, her stardom stems from a deep cultural context and from her ability to perform specifically Italian jokes and discourse. Loren's humbler beginnings coincided at the time that Italy's cinematic landscape was undergoing a dramatic change in the 1950s. Neorealism was beginning to fade away and genre films were beginning to re-emerge in popularity, which saw the rise of pink neorealism, a more conservative, rose-tinted take on the neorealist movement. Combining the naturalistic style with more of a melodramatic or comedic tone, instead of non-professional cast, they often featured a glamorous leading lady, what was known as the pink vamp. Layam claims Sophia Loren was promoted as the Italian reaction to Hollywood stars such as Rita Hayworth and Ava Gardner, imbuing her film roles and her life outside film with a compelling combination of coquettish exotic beauty, a traditional matriarch, a glamorous everywoman. She became the perfect poster child for the values to which a conservative audience would be clamoring to return, and Hollywood too, it seems, was eager to export. The cultural value that is assigned to drama over comedy, which is often marginalized as a lower form of entertainment, could give further reason to Loren's greater global status through the exportation of films like La Ciociara, which was the film that earned her the Academy Award for Best Actress. However, comedy having the longevity that it has in Italian culture does not leave Cortellesi short of the recognition she works for.
Paola Cortellesi per il film Nessuno Vi Può Giudicare.
She was awarded the Davide di Donatello Award for her role in Nessuno Mi Può Giudicare, in which she plays a fallen bourgeois woman who has to resort to prostitution in order to pay off her late husband's debts and keep custody of their son. A premise which just as easily could have been a tragedy, yet one that is sadly not out of the realm of possibility, given Italy's current economic climate. could be argued that Cortellesi's appeal stems from her relatability, as so many of her characters fall into the same plight as so many Italians of today, struggling to find stable work in a struggling economy. While Cortellesi herself is obviously widely successful, and her characters often resort to parodic extremes, she radiates a humble, self-aware quality. Her building popularity, no doubt, is proof of how her films speak to a specific audience. Cortellesi seems to continually seek out work which aims to engage in a dialogue with her country's values and social issues, particularly the rising unemployment rate, workplace discrimination and alienation of young people and the working class in Italy. It is important to understand the context of her work, as it is not all that dissimilar to the time of Lorraine's rise to notoriety. According to Gunsberg, Italian comedy began to flourish in the late 50s, with films that began to explore and satirize the plight of the working class at a time where unemployment and migration was at an all-time high. She offers that, in this context of intensified commodification of social relations, the subversive possibilities inherent in the comic genre, and the social progressiveness encouraged by the spread of globalized medium of television, rub against the status quo of patriarchal ideology, which continues to construct femininity as arena for relations between men, with the commodification of female sexuality as the basis of these relations. This results in a general marginalization of femininity and a closing down, with a few exceptions, of the possibilities for anything other than the reinforcement of traditional gender roles and relations. Enter the Maggiorata, or the Sweater Girl, a persona constructed with the intention of embodying a natural urban image, reflecting the star's humble origins in her on-screen roles. Many of Lorraine's earlier roles entailed playing poor working-class characters in provincial Italy or poorer urban suburbs, single mothers and even prostitutes. However, Lorraine destabilizes the traditional male-oriented narrative and defies marginalization through her assertive femininity and the power of her star image. She replaces the traditional gender dynamic by demanding a narrative of her own, transforming the comedy and patriarchal ideology into almost a satire of itself. Lorraine says of herself in an interview, "In Two Women, Yesterday, Today and Tomorrow, and Marriage Italian Style, I played submissive women. I like to play such roles because I think I can help some women to wake up. But what I represent for the public, I don't know. I'm just a member of the family, the sister, the wife, the lover." Gunsberg raises the hypothetical question of the feminine comedy, should it purely exist. A female character would need to subvert stereotypical binaries, like that of the Madonna and the Whore. One whose narrative is not tied to marriage or the domestic sphere. While Commedia all'Italiana was intrinsically occupied with this subject due to the time period of its conception, Italian comedy has potential for this kind of transgression. Paola Cortellesi herself has made incredible strides in the way of female representation in the subgenre, and arguably has already approached the concept with films like Scusate Se Esisto, which is not to say that the path laid down for her by stars like Lorraine is any less significant. To compare them would be like Mele e Arance. Sophia Loren is the closest that Italy has come to an international movie star, possibly because she was born in the right place at the right time, or because she simply possesses an innate quality that simply can't be learned. Regardless, Paola Cortellesi may not have the same global status, but her social relevance and consistent presence in the Italian film industry today is encouraging, to say the least. To say the most would be that she is just as important in the long history of Italian cinema.
Is there anyone you see around you now, 10 years younger, 15 years younger, who's going to be another Sophia Loren?
I don't know, no. For the moment. You mean in Italian movies?
In world movies.
What does that mean, to be another Sophia Loren?
Exactly.